Perhaps before going on, we should try and answer some of the questions posed by the critics, beginning with the most fundamental question of all: was there really a man named Moses? According to the book of Exodus, at the time Moses was born, the Pharaoh of Egypt had decreed that all male Hebrew children be killed. The mother of Moses, unwilling to follow this horrible edict, put her young son in a basket made of reeds and set it adrift on the river. The daughter of Pharaoh found the basket and took the child for her own son. Moses was transformed from the child of Hebrew slaves to the grandson of the Pharaoh in a single day. But Moses' life in the court of the Pharaoh came to an abrupt end when he saw an Egyptian taskmaster beating a Hebrew slave, and in a rage, Moses attacked the Egyptian and killed him. From that moment on, Moses became a fugitive from the wrath of Pharaoh, which brings us to the beginning of the most controversial series of events in the Bible. Moses fled into the desert to escape the Pharaoh's soldiers. After wandering for many days, he came across a small tribe of nomadic shepherds in what was then the land of Midian. He is befriended by Jethro, the head of one of the families, and there he determines to stay. In one stroke, Moses is transformed from Prince of Egypt to wandering shepherd. And so far as Moses is concerned, that will be his lot in life. But it was not to be. One day, while in the desert, he was startled by the sight of a burning bush that, while fully involved in flame, was not consumed. The Lord spoke to him out of the bush and told him he must return to Egypt.
Critics are quick to point to this episode as proof the Bible is pure fantasy. Even apart from the burning bush, how could a middle-aged shepherd who, by his own admission, was not a good speaker, be expected to go into Egypt, where he was still under sentence of death, and simply tell the Pharaoh he has to give up hundreds of thousands of slaves?
The answer, according to the Bible, is a series of plagues that God permits Moses to call down upon the Egyptians. There are plagues of frogs and flies, of the water in wells, rivers, fountains, even urns turning to blood, of boils, dying cattle, and fiery hail. Finally, Moses names the most devastating plague. The firstborn of every Egyptian household will die.
And therein lies the problem. Critics insist that the Egyptians were such astute record keepers that something so tragic, so all-encompassing, would certainly have been recorded by their own scribes as well as by Moses. As it turns out, recent discoveries have proven them right.
And there's an ancient Egyptian papyrus document called the Ipuwer Papyrus, and it recounts in eyewitness fashion the plague of blood, the plague of cattle disease, the plague of strange fire phenomena, the plague on the firstborn, the strange darkness, all the events that we previously thought we only knew about from the Bible. We can read about it in Egyptian records.
Given the severity of these plagues, it is not unlikely that the Pharaoh would at last let the people of Israel go. But somewhere along the line, he had a change of heart.
And here the biblical record stands alone in its depiction of what many still regard as an unbelievable miracle. Yet except for this miracle, there would be no Bible or the possibility of a Bible code. Pharaoh's army of chariots was rapidly gaining on the slow-moving mass of humanity trying to make its way across the wilderness of Sinai. Suddenly, they found themselves facing the Red Sea with the Pharaoh's army closing in from behind. Moses, according to the Bible, raised his arms and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind that provided the children of Israel with an escape route. We can only imagine what a great act of faith it was for the children of Israel to follow the bidding of Moses and rush out into what just moments before had been an impassable sea. The way was open before them, but it was only a narrow strip of land with a wall of water on both sides. Behind them, the Pharaoh's army, bent on destruction, pressed forward. Terrified, but facing certain death, they rushed out onto the narrow bridge of land. It is not hard to imagine the Pharaoh's army coming to a standstill, staring in disbelief at the fleeing Israelites and giving them precious time to complete the crossing. According to tradition, Moses was the last to cross, and by the time he reached the other side, the Pharaoh's chariots and soldiers had recovered from their own fear and surprise and were already pouring out across the land bridge in angry pursuit. Theirs, however, was to be a different fate. The wind ceased and the water rushed in upon the Egyptian army, drowning men and horses alike. But could such a thing really have happened? Oddly enough, it was Napoleon who first discovered that indeed it could.
At this site in 1799, Napoleon's engineers discovered an underwater ridge some 600 feet wide that extended from shore to shore. His engineers calculated the right time for crossing this 5.2 mile strip when the east wind would blow sufficiently to clear the seabed of water. Napoleon, however, barely escaped with his life when a sudden change in the wind's direction brought an onrush of water covering this strip within just a matter of minutes.
Of course, those were 18th century engineers, and their records did little to satisfy the critics. 20th century scientists, however, have taken up the challenge with surprising results. Dr. Doran Knopf, professor of oceanography at the University of Florida, has developed an experiment to test the viability of the biblical account of Moses and the children of Israel crossing the Red Sea.
We were intrigued by the possibility that perhaps there is some explanation for a similar process. So what we did, we developed what we call in physical oceanography a mathematical model of the part of the Red Sea where many people believe that crossing could have been. Okay, what we have here now is a physical model of the Red Sea. The deep part supposed to represent the main body of the Red Sea, which is about 2,000 or 3,000 feet deep. And the shallow part, with the one with the sloping bottom, supposed to represent the Gulf of Suez, which is much shallower. As we said before, the average depth of the Gulf of Suez is about 100 feet, and the length is few hundred miles. Okay, what we have in addition to this, we have here, we introduced here an artificial ridge, which you see right here, and the depth of the water above that artificial ridge is only about 10 feet high. Okay, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to let the wind blow from here, and you will see how the water recedes and in fact exposes the ridge to the air. Okay, so what you can see now is that most of the water, in fact, to the left of the ridge is blown away. There is still some water there, and you see that there is an exposed area right there. All right? So the idea is that the Israelis crossed on this part of the ridge which was exposed, and they saw water on the two sides, right? They saw the water on the left side of the ridge and the water on the right side. And I'm going to cut the wind off now, and I'm going to do that abruptly, and you will see how it comes back. So let's do that. And of course, what happens after that is that when the wind relaxes, the water wants to come back to the position that it had before, and it does that via a gravity wave, which moves at the speed we calculated to be like 15 feet per second or so, which is, of course, a speed that one cannot escape.
Dr. Knopf's experiment demonstrates that the strong east wind could indeed have opened a passage through the Red Sea sufficient for the children of Israel to cross. And as Napoleon demonstrated, once the wind stopped, there could be no escape for the Pharaoh's army. Modern research has shown that it was possible for the fleeing slaves to have crossed the Red Sea at this particular point. But how do we know this is where Moses brought his people? Once again, modern technology shows the way. Literally. Infrared satellite imaging has tracked a large migration of people, their campsites, and their direction across the Sinai Peninsula with an astonishing correlation to the biblical account in Exodus.
With satellite infrared photography, there have been major archaeological discoveries found throughout the world. There's a trail that comes down the west branch of the Red Sea, The left-hand branch of it comes down to the tip of the Sinai Peninsula, stops there. It appears to come out the other side and then wanders north to the highest mountain in the area, Jabal al-Lawz. And we did find what I think is important archaeological evidence that something took place at Jabal al-Lawz. We found at the base of this mountain 12 pillars, 18 and a half feet in diameter. Why not 7? Why not 11? Why 12? With 12 tribes of Moses fitting so perfectly into that scenario. Additionally, on the flat in front of this mountain, we found a large pile of rocks about 20, 24 feet tall. There's a petroglyph of an Egyptian, not an Arabic drawing, but an Egyptian drawing of the golden calf. And additionally, at the base of the mountain, we found kind of a wing-shaped formation, foundation pointing towards the mountain, and there we found marble, round marble stones. This is some of the stone of it. This rock is not indigenous to that area of Saudi Arabia, let alone to Saudi Arabia. Somebody brought this in a tremendous distance. Something really did take place at this mountain, and it may well have been the Exodus.
All these findings seem to confirm the discovery of the real Mount Sinai according to information provided in the Bible. Could this then be the actual route of the Exodus? Are we now within sight of the biblical Mount Sinai and the miraculous meeting that produced the Torah?